Jesse Wilcox Smith, Elizabeth Shippen Green, Emily Sartain. Several years ago, she was a curator at the Woodyard Museum, an amazing retrospective exhibit at the Violet Oakley, and I was very privileged to see this, and I know many members here have seen this, and we have a couple copies of the catalog from that exhibit. Well, it was almost fate that these women became the area of her professional research. She is a graduate of two pioneering colleges for women, Remar College and Moore College of Art and Design, which was the first women's art school in the United States. And where did she reside when she was at Moore? Sartain Hall. But when she inquired, nobody seemed to know why this residence hall was called Sartain. So she started asking, she started researching. She learned that Emily Sartain, a painter, an engraver, and also an educator, who in 1886 became the director of the Philadelphia School of Design for Women, later Moore College, and always a champion for opportunity for women artists, and Sartain in 1897 with Alice Barber Stevens founded the Plastic Club. Patricia was very busy with her day jobs, teaching, research, lecturing, and she nevertheless graciously agreed to write our application to the state for her historical marker. And somebody said, oh, you're so lucky that she agreed to be paid to do this. Oh no, this is the Plastic Club. She volunteered to do this.
Books. the country, approaching the history of women artists from different angles. You can go to the index, and yes, the plastic block. It was a moment, it was an event, it was a turning point. And that is a real achievement that it's easy to forget when it's your friendly little neighborhood club that you enjoy going to, which has a nice history. You don't always know how it looms large in other people's worldview. So that is a real achievement. And the other thing that is significant is that the papers and records of the Plastic Club have been preserved in the Historical Society of Pennsylvania, and you can be sure they don't just fill up that place with, you know, pieces of paper and cardboard boxes that they think no one will be interested in. And because it was preserved there, an organization called the Archives of American Art microfilmed those same documents and now will be digitizing them. So this is a measure of the historical significance of the Plastic Club. Now, the women artists who were part of this, especially in the early days, their works have been acquired by museums all over the country, and right now they can be seen at the Academy in a large exhibition called Women in Motion, which is about networking. And networking is what the Plastic Club was all about, but they didn't have that word then. But they still knew how to do it. And that's a wonderful show that some of us visited together. And you could see a lot of beautiful work by these members. So my question is, could Emily Sartain and Alice Barber Stevens have imagined that the club they founded in 1897 would still be alive and well 125 years later? What accounts for the Plastic Club's remarkable longevity? On this occasion, I think it's worth reflecting on how we arrived at this historic moment. And that means going back 20 years or so before the Plastic Club. The Plastic Club was built on the foundation of the women's club movement that swept through the United States in the last quarter of the 19th century. Women's clubs were ostensibly about shared interests in culture, art, literature, public school education, and philanthropy. But they were often a means of expanding women's participation in social reform and progressive causes. In some cases, they were outright fronts for the suffrage movement, but we would say they went under the radar, so they weren't creating, let's say, problems at home. Now, one of the first of these clubs was called the New Century Club of Philadelphia, and it was founded by Elizabeth Duane Gillespie, who was the great-granddaughter of Benjamin Franklin and Eliza Sprode Turner. These women were suffragists who had raised money to build a separate women's pavilion at the Centennial Exposition, which was in Fairmount Park, in 1876, to showcase women's contributions in the arts, crafts, and the sciences. They had been asked to raise money to support the Centennial, and they agreed to do it if they would be given an exhibition space. And they were told they were. And then they were told they were. And so they said that we want our own building. So this was the very first time that women had a status like a nation of their own. Another country, the country of women, wants a building in order to show what they had. So it was very important. The actual exhibition was a bit of a disappointment. There was a lot of bric-a-brac and doily making and lace and decorative china and the sort of work that women did do in the home. There was also wonderful professional printmaking, including a few prints by mezzotints by Emily Sartain. But the big attraction was a woman who knew how to run a steam engine. And that was apparently what everyone gathered around. And she would turn that on or crank it up. I don't know. But somehow she was able to do that. Well, the following year, these two women formed the New Century Club, and that name did not refer to the 20th century. It referred to the second century of the United States, because the first century, nothing much had happened to improve the situation of women. So they were already taking the long view of the second century coming up. So they formed the New Century Club for Professional Women and Women Rights Activists. And by 1891, they had amassed a large amount of funds, and they hired a Minerva Parker Nichols, who was certainly the first woman artist, architect in Philadelphia to have her own practice, to design this Renaissance Revival clubhouse for them. Which was built at 12th and Sansom, and sadly is no longer standing. But among their 400 or so members was Emily Sartain. And this is one of the reasons why I think Emily Sartain felt she had the experience and a sense of security about forming a club of her own. She would have spent over 10 years at least as a member of this very well-run club that involved women from all the different professions. Now, as the daughter of John Sartain, who was a printmaker, a publisher of his own magazine, Sartain's Magazine, that published people like Edgar Allan Poe, and he held administrative positions at the Academy and also at the School of Design for Women. She was also the sister of the painter Will Sartain. Emily had exceptional opportunities compared to most women artists. She did not really need a club of any kind to enhance her career. She had achieved professional recognition as a mezzotint engraver, that was her father's profession, and as a painter. But unlike her father and brother, she was not eligible for membership in either of Philadelphia's prestigious art clubs. The Sketch Club on Kamak Street, and if you'd like to know where that is, I can. You can use Google Maps, but do the walk. If you do car, it'll just be easy. But the Sketch Club was the established much earlier, before the Civil War, in 1860, and boasted the painters Thomas Aikens and Thomas Anschutz, who were both instructors at the Academy, among their members. There was another very large club called the Art Club, which was founded in 1887, and this catered to a wider range of professionals that included architects, painters, sculptors, musicians, and other Philadelphia notables like the Biddles and the Strawbridges. They held exhibitions and lectures in a new Venetian Gothic clubhouse designed by Frank Miles Day on Broad and Chancellor Street, and sadly, no longer with us since the 70s. The 70s was a time when a lot of these important earlier buildings went down because they were just so old-fashioned, people couldn't, the more progressive architects couldn't bear to look at them, so they were, a lot of them were torn down. Now, the Art Club did open its receptions to the public, and they recorded the attendance figures in three categories. They would have a list of the number of members, who were all men, then a list called ladies, and then another list called ladies accompanied by a gentleman. And I have tried to figure out why they did this. There were no addresses to see the unaccompanied ladies if you wanted to get in touch with them. But according to their statistics, more unaccompanied ladies attended, who apparently did not require an escort to appreciate more. But more research needs to be done on this topic, or not. But in 1897, Emily, who was then head of the Philadelphia School of Design for Women, became acutely aware of the lack of a professional organization that could assist her students in having successful careers. And so we see here that her, the idea for the plastic club grows out of a kind of selflessness and also solidarity with other women. It was not really going to, she reached the pinnacle of her profession. It would add nothing but more work for her. But she felt, she knew how important it would be for her students. Now, she had hired Alice Barber Stevens, who had studied like she had at the academy, but was also an important, very well-known illustrator whose work was much admired. And she hired her to teach at the School of Design. And one of, is that part of the celebration? It's okay, because we're in a festive mood. But one of the other things that concerned Emily Sartain was that there was a hierarchy in the art world between the painters and the sculptors, printmakers, fine art, printmakers were within that category as well. But the artists who worked in advertising and illustration, who were paid for their piecework, and who used many of the same skills, were considered to be of a lower status. And this was true also of the designers, because the School of Design for Women trained textile designers and wallpaper designers and a whole range of industrial, what we call basically industrial design today. And she felt that the curriculum needed to be upgraded. So she hired Alice Barber Stevens to teach there, to have a life drawing class. She created a fine arts foundation program within this design school. And that became standard. If you think of some of our local schools, if you remember when the University of Arts was the first started, and that included also commercial applications of art, applied art. But it was all based on this foundation level of drawing from the figure, learning perspective, learning to work with different materials. So she upgraded the curriculum. And her vision, she and Alice Barber Stevens, was that they would form a club that included all of these women. They were well aware that many of these women had to work for a living. And three of them, whose names are on that plaque out there, started out having to make money with their illustration. They had fallen into the genteel poor category. I'm talking about Violet Oakley, whose father never recovered from a nervous breakdown after the panic of 1893 and had to support her mother. Elizabeth Shippen Green's father, Jacob Green, was quite a well-known architect, working for Harper's. He was actually a Civil War illustrator, but he was now an elderly man, and she was the only child, so she needed the money that she earned. And Jessie Wilcox Smith started out being a kindergarten teacher, which she claimed that she was too tall for that job. But apparently, bending down, she got a good look at those kids because she was able to make a really quite a fabulous living off of them and supported other members of her family. So many of the women who had gone to the School of Design had no choice but to earn their own living for their sake or for their families. So this inclusiveness, which did not distinguish between the quality of art for art's sake or art for commercial use, attracted an enthusiastic group of 57 women who first met at the reception hall of the School of Design for Women, which was then on Broad Street, in March of 1897. Now, to distinguish their organization from the others in the city, they certainly couldn't call the art club, that was already taken, printmaker Blanche DeLay, the first president of the Plastic Club, after it was actually established, and Emily Sartain kind of ran it in the initial state, suggested naming it Plastic, and everybody in this room knows the reasons for for that, but that was a very unusual thing to do. It still requires some explanation from people. It's actually a German art aesthetic term, plastique with a K, and it referred to works of art not only being malleable because of their materials, which even charcoal is, move it around, but the fact that works of art are in process. They're in a state of becoming until we, you know, let them go. And so that must have struck a chord with them as they were making this organization and kind of shaping it, not knowing where it would go. Well, the professional prestige of the founders, Sartain, Stevens, and DeLay, garnered the support of famous artists like Cecilia Beaux, who we've heard about before, as well as, you know, unknowns and aspiring artists. But word must have spread quickly because only a year later, the new organization was discussed in a book called The History of the Women's Club Movement in America. And an entry said, and I quote, "There are in America many clubs for the furtherance of art interests. Painters' clubs, sculptors' clubs, illustrators' clubs, from which women are excluded. Philadelphia possesses an art club that excludes men." So there's a little bit of, scorekeeping going on there. And she goes on to say, "The Plastic Club, formed in the spring of 1897, has on its list of 125, I'm not making it up, destiny, that we don't remember, has on its list of 125 members all the women artists of any prominence in the Quaker City." Well, despite the support from within the Women's Club Federation, the Plastic Club second annual report did acknowledge that there was some resistance. "We had prejudices to meet and overcome. We had the belittling prejudice against women's art clubs, and we had to justify ourselves. But we have established ourselves as an art club, as one quoted, recognized, and respected, not only in our own city, but in other great cities. We have shown that there was room for us, that we were needed, that from us might emanate a new art interest that adds to and aids the art in Philadelphia." Well, by 1901, the membership had only increased to 140 members, but within 10 years, it reached 260. In addition to professional advancement, the members were drawn by the novelty of having a social life of dinners and parties outside of the home, and the sheer fun of attending events like the Rabbit, the annual themed costume party. Gradually, the Plastic Club's image improved, and in 1912, the Philadelphia Inquirer described it as a bohemian organization of well-known women. And probably invite that reporter to the Rabbit, where everyone was wearing strange costumes. Well, the mission of the Plastic Club was, and I assume is, to promote a wider knowledge of art and to advance its interests by means of exhibitions and social intercourse among artists. Now, mission statements are often sound nicer than they turn out to be, but this club was really committed to delivering to its members, and it exhibited and still does exhibit the members' work twice a year, and it honored its commitment to broaden the members' horizons. Since most of the women were not likely to spend time in Paris where Japanese art was a craze, the Plastic Club held exhibitions and lectures on Japanese prints and on hanging scrolls, and they advertised their programs with striking posters created by the members that demonstrated their talents. Some of them can be seen here today. Are they downstairs? Yes, take a walk through there if you want a stroll. One of the authors that I read mentioned that they thought that the Plastic Club got very good attention because it knew how to advertise itself with impressive posters in an era when the poster, especially in France, you think Toulouse-Lautrec, and you mentioned Alphonse the Czech art Vogue artist Alphonse Mucha, whose posters are still around online. People still love them. Posters were really important, and that was a kind of a new art form in the United States. And there was an example where having people worked in commercial industry, dare I say, knew about marketing, was helpful to the organization. So the Plastic Club offered its members life drawing classes, workshops in different media, and courses in French. And to stay informed about the history of art and emerging trends, the members also assembled a library on the premises. Now, although the Plastic Club was created for women, participating as equals in the male-dominated art world was always the goal. Consequently, they cultivated professional relationships with prominent male artists, which I think Susan was talking about. They had exhibitions of the work of Max Parrish, Henry Carter, William Glackens. They had a lecture series that included the Impressionist painter William Merritt Chase, the illustrator Howard Pyle, and the architect Will Price, Rose Valley fame. And eventually, men were allowed to join the Plastic Club. Now, it was 94 years after they opened, but nevertheless. Since 1991, they have been full members and contributed to the leadership of the organization, as we've been hearing about. Well, Plastic Club members were also civic-minded, and during World War I, they joined the Liberty Bond poster campaign and contributed funds to families of deployed servicemen. They endowed a hospital bed in France. The French connection seems to be quite strong in the early years of this organization. During World War II, club members served in the USO. They made art classes available to soldiers. And the Plastic Club offered exhibition space to regional organizations and made donations to the Children's Aid Society. We heard some of their more updated activities. Well, during its first decade, the club met in rented rooms at 10 South 18th Street while funds were raised to buy a building to accommodate the growing membership and exhibition programs. Members sold little postcards of their artwork and had auctions and various things to raise money. And in 1909, they were able to purchase two combined row houses on Camac Street on the same block as the exclusively male sketch club. Now, whether it was a coincidence or destiny or a realtor who had been keeping them informed of available buildings, I can't say. But the Plastic Club's presence on the same street for 110 years expressed their determination to be considered on a par with their male colleagues. And this building, or buildings, this current headquarters, was placed on the Philadelphia Historic Register of Buildings in 1962. So the Plastic Club's significance has been known. It happens intermittently, but it's been going on for a long time. So why has the Plastic Club endured? Well, visionary leadership, certainly, perseverance through hard times, and the loyalty of its members. But I would say that creativity also played a part. Creativity is identified with artistic expression, but it is a transferable skill. The art-making process entails problem-solving to attain the desired effect, finding alternatives, generating new ideas. Creative thinkers are flexible and adapt to change conditions, aware that even an unanticipated or unwelcome change may result in a better solution. How else but creative adaptation can we explain why the Plastic Club survived the political swings of 22 American presidents, the Great Depression, the Great Recession, two World Wars, and two pandemics, the 1918 influenza pandemic, and COVID-19. Creativity was displayed in the club's recent response to the COVID shutdown, when the Plastic Club increased and diversified its online programming and actually gained to return to our first question, did the founders ever imagine that the plastic club could last for 125 years? Well, the motto they chose was, all passes, art alone endures. So perhaps they did. Thank you.